Staff crisis deepens within our state's health system. Triage tents are now being erected at some southeast hospitals to deal with the overflow of patients.
A car park, now a makeshift waiting room. The Gold Coast University Hospital preparing for emergency patients.
Some of it's just overflow and making sure that we do not have congested emergency departments.
The government says part of reducing congestion is also reducing visitors. Only two per patient will be allowed into general Queensland Health Hospital wards, and just one visitor per person into emergency.
Of course, there'll be exceptions to that rule, particularly around palliative care, end-of-life visits and maternity.
The Chief Health Officer says hospitals are being hit by increasing cases, particularly in Cairns, on the Gold Coast and across Brisbane.
There's quite a bit of activity in Ipswich, which is causing pressure on Ipswich Hospital.
Insiders at Ipswich say each day is a struggle and there are COVID patients across five wards, despite only one ward having negative pressure to restrict airflow.
There'll never be enough negative pressure rooms to put every COVID patient in when you start having transmission so wide in the community.
Adding to the system pressure, the government says more than 6,000 Queensland health workers are currently on leave, either because they have COVID or are close contacts. Included in that figure, nearly 400 Queensland ambulance staff.
About 150 of those close contacts have been called back to work. To assist in those hospitals where we're seeing the largest number of cases, including the Gold Coast.
And more callbacks might be needed as hospitalisations rise.
We are planning for numbers in the thousands.
Tim Arvia, Nine News.
Queensland's reached another grim COVID record, our new deadliest day. 16 people have died in the past 24 hours. And as cases continue to surge, crucial testing kits are still in short supply.
Only 5 weeks into Queensland's latest COVID wave and the death toll is mounting.
Omicron finds the elderly who haven't had a booster.
Of the 16 new deaths reported today, all are above 70 years of age. The majority were in aged care. None of them had received a booster.
The virus does seem to be finding older people who have not received that third dose.
45 people have lost their lives to COVID in this current outbreak. Most have died in hospital. A large portion passed away in aged care homes, and some have died at home.
We do know in aged care they're the most vulnerable. There hasn't been 100% take-up of boosters, and I want to know why.
More than 800 people are tonight in hospital with the virus. 50 are in intensive care, 18 on ventilators. Tens of thousands more with symptoms are recovering at home. Despite overwhelming demand for rapid testing kits, supplies are still limited. The federal government is sending 100,000 kits to Queensland this week. The state government says it's simply not enough.
50,000 of those are point of care tests that are not really suitable for our public testing clinics.
Free rapid antigen or PCR tests are available at testing facilities.
This new TV ad rolled out by the Commonwealth has the state health minister seeing red.
To actually be running these ads knowing that there is not enough supply at our public testing clinics to give everyone who turns up with symptoms or is a close contact a free test is, I think, irresponsible.
But he has said that it was up to the states to source the supply of the tests.
I think that's a bit rich that the Commonwealth are spending money, taxpayers' dollars, running ads about what the state public testing clinics are providing.
With retail supplies emptied out, the Pharmacy Guild is preparing to launch a website within a week which will show which stores are in stock, verified data to ease the pressure. Josh Babbis, Nine News.
As the federal government faces those mounting calls for more rapid tests, it made another move today to ease pressure on the health system, activating its emergency plan with private hospitals. Meanwhile, there's growing threats from the unions, and strikes could be on the cards if changes to isolation rules force sick people to go to work.
Finding himself in the driver's seat, the Treasurer wants to make some noise. But changing rules for close contacts has unions making noise of their own.
Workers do have a right to stop work.
Threatening to strike if sick people are told to stay on the job.
It's fear-mongering at exactly the wrong time.
As Omicron puts greater strain on hospitals, access to the private system has been opened up.
Up to 57,000 nurses and over 100,000 staff made available.
The government says more protective equipment and rapid tests are also on the way. Unions insist those quicker tests are key to keeping workplaces safer, urging businesses to join our efforts to make rapid antigen tests free.
Business can't afford to pay for hundreds and thousands, millions of rapid tests.
It's a tool that we need to be able to use, and right now it's simply not available.
The Labor leader says his views are clear.
These tests should be free.
It's a very dangerous and irresponsible policy.
And as the UK government considers a policy of 0 days mandated isolation for COVID-positive people, the chief medical officer says isolation periods here may need to change.
Now is the time to think about what we do into the future. COVID's going to be with us for many years.
As the government tries to find solutions to a myriad of problems, it has a problem of its own. Months out from the election, its support appears to be falling.
Polling in the Sydney Morning Herald and The Age shows in August, when Sydney was a month into lockdown and Melbourne just entered its last shutdown, the Coalition had a primary vote of 40% compared to Labor's 32%. Fast forward to January, the government has dropped below Labor to just 34%. Scott Morrison's rating as preferred Prime Minister has also slumped, a lead over Anthony Albanese of 23 points in August, cut to just 7.
This Prime Minister is characterised by always waiting for a problem to become a crisis before he acts.
The government has also lost favour in areas it thinks its strongest support for its COVID response, dipping from 37 to 32%, just 4 points ahead of Labor. And its approval for handling the economy has dropped, but is still comfortably ahead of the opposition.
We're in the first set of a five-set match.
Jonathan Kersley, Nine News.
Australia's decision to reopen despite the Omicron wave has other countries questioning whether it was a good idea. Sophie Walsh looks at how we're faring on the world stage.
Well, this map shows confirmed cases per million people over 2 weeks starting in March 2020. The darker the colour, the more infections. As you can see, Australia was looking good back then, but fast forward to a month ago and it's a different story. We are fast becoming one of the worst places in the world for new COVID cases, well in front of the United States, United Kingdom, Italy and Spain for cases per million people. But keep in mind, while there has been a recent uptick, our COVID death rate remains one of the lowest in the world. In the initial waves, we had one death for every 100 people infected. With Omicron, we're seeing a death rate 10 times lower than that, all thanks to the vaccine, which will hold us in good stead for when the next surge is expected this winter.